Good evening, or yeah, so good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. For me, it's right now it's evening, but tomorrow, when we meet in person, it will be afternoon. So, as I mentioned in the introductory video, I would like to talk about the case study. So, actually, you can read it, so I would like to summarize it. That what are the important and significant points of it, and orient your focus, because mostly, when, as a student, when I had to work with case studies, sometimes they were too simplified, or sometimes there was not enough data, or they were unrealistic. So, when I made this simulated company, I tried to collect as many data as possible, and as realistic data as possible. Sometimes I had to do estimation, but still it's worse. The job, so that's why you can feel that you are flooded with data intentionally. Because if you have to work as an economist, then there are no simple situations to live with. So that's why you have to learn to adapt, and you have to learn to select what is relevant, and you have to learn what to select what is irrelevant in this case. So we have a company which operates in Europe, obviously, because this is easy stuff. So there are railway networks everywhere in the continent, and if you are checking the legislation, then you can see that on the website of the European Commission that actually the national freight market, so cargo transportation, is liberalized. So if you have a license somewhere in the European Union, and if your vehicles are licensed, have a license in one member state, then you can operate there and elsewhere. So just you have to meet the national standards, but otherwise you are not. So there are no monopolies on the market. In the case of the passenger transportation, there are some national monopolies, but if I remember well, in 2022 or 24, they had to be abandoned. So after that, this market will be liberalized, but I'm waiting so much because if you traveled already with the Hungarian Railway Company, then you know what I'm thinking about. So actually, they started to open this market in the early 90s, and today you have to have you have to separate the entire railway market to three different parts. So one part is the infrastructure, so all the literal rails, train stations, lines, electricity, so all the supporting infrastructure. This can be, and sometimes it has to be, in the hand of the state. So for example, in Hungary, the state had to be a majority voting power in railway infrastructure company. So this is the law. But if you want to use this infrastructure, you have to pay fees. So you have to pay after kilometers, you have to pay after tonnage, so the weight of the train, and you have to pay for the electricity. And of course, there are other minor issues. So if you need traction services, or you want to stop at the station, you have to pay for it. But right now we are not dealing with this expenditures, just mileage, so kilometers, and tons, so weight, will be in our expenditures. And also, there can be cargo, or there can be passenger. We are not dealing with passengers at all. So it's a completely different market. Sometimes it's a quasi-monopoly, sometimes it's a full monopoly, maybe it will be liberalized in the near future, doesn't matter. We are focusing only on cargo, so with containers, timber, grain, everything in wagons, and then it pulled by a locomotive. So this is what we can focus today, and if you are focusing on or looking on the book, so we can see that the entire company starts not that starts this operation, but right now in this situation, you are in early 2020, January 1st, and you literally don't know anything about all the mess that will happen in this year. But you can be happy, and you can have illusions. So, there is this Flatland Trans company, which is a public traded company with the headquarters in Hungary, and it has two subsidiaries, one in Austria and the other in Czech Republic. So let's show you on the map. So here we are with the headquarter and one subsidiary in Austria and the other in Czechia. Okay, and they started the operations in 2004, and they opened these subsidiaries by purchasing foreign companies because it was easier to grab their license and operations and that's all. And what they are doing here, they are responsible for the traction of a daily Bremen-Chapel container freight train between the Czech-German border and Chapel port. So that is somewhere Bremenhaven. So this is one of the most important European harbors. So all the stuff that is coming from China or from other regions is docking here. And after that, they are putting these containers on a train, and somehow it manages to go to the Czech border. And after that, we have the traction service. So we don't own any kind of wagons. We don't own cargo, we don't own any kind of containers. We are providing service for our client by pulling all of this stuff from this border through Czechia, through Austria, through Hungary, and after that we are unloading this train in Budapest in Csepel, because Csepel is a major harbor next to the Danube River. Let's zoom in. If we can do it, then let's show it to you. So actually, here you can see that there is this harbor, and if we are zooming in enough, then we can see that, oh, there is logistics, cargo distribution. So there are many companies, lots of companies who are operating here, and actually you have to go through this bridge. This bridge is actually in complete rubbish situation, but it doesn't matter for us because we are not dealing with infrastructure at all. So we are stopping here, and then our partner will move everything through this railway line to the port. So yeah, we are just providing service like this. And the company is in troubles because the previous CEO signed a contract at the end of the last year to provide distraction services for 11 million euros per year, but actually our pre-tax profit, the revenues ratio, is zero. Okay, 0.006, but it's zero at current exchange rate. Oh, come on, 315 euros for a euro. It was a long time ago, but they were not profitable. And at the same time, industrial average was around 0.3, so it's still pre-COVID numbers from the last 5 years. And the owners were not impressed with the lack of profitability, so they fired the old or previous CEO, and now you are hired to provide a new strategy. So you and your team should make profit. So you have to make a plan, a strategy. So in your first assignment, actually you have to make some suggestions for the company, and you have to, at least on the seminar, we will work around it. So how can we improve the profitability of this company? And then during the entire semester, we will verify this strategy. So what is happening under different exchange rates, how it affects the bankruptcy ratio of the company, how we can get funding, should we have financial lease contract or not. So we will work around and work out this strategy as many ways as possible, because profitability ratio is one thing, but sensitivity is another. So what kind of assets do we have here? So we have fixed assets, obviously, because it's a real company. So we have this ownership in other companies, so in the Czech and Austrian subsidiaries. You can fire people there, but you can't close them, or you can't sell these companies at this price because it's useless. So it's a sunken, so it's an immobile stuff what is here. But rolling stock and locomotives. So we have this Postlok Hero diesel locomotive. Actually, if you are checking the internet, then Postlok was a German company. And so right now, or in the last two decades, actually, the market of diesel engines is dying, but shrinking a lot. So actually, Postlok sold all their operations in the locomotive construction business and in the they provided not only locomotives but maybe trams or something like this. So they sold everything. So they are now focused their operations way more than before, and now Stadler owns this trademark and all the construction and patents. But it has a nice voice. So listen. This is how you can burn diesel fuel with a nice voice. So, and then you can see the containers. So this is your day job at the company. So this is how you can get your money. And with the ETCS train safety system, so ETCS is a harmonized train safety system. It's not perfect, but in this case study it works well, and it's able to manage, it provides a universal safety system for all the infrastructure, so the train can communicate with the railway network and backwards. So yeah, you don't have to deal with all the national subsystems at all, because I did not want it to make a logistic case study, it's a financial case study. Top speed of the vehicle is something, it's a bit slow, but actually you will see that, so we have to pull this train, it will have a weight, and so it's heavy. It's a heavy train, and that's why you don't want to have high speeds, because you have to slow down somehow, you have to stop sometimes, and you know, according to the laws of physics, it can be tricky if you have huge weights. Traction power is half of electric counterparts. Yeah. Depreciation is calculated at 20 years and linear. So actually we purchased it many years ago and now it still has some value. Actually, there are some hints how to rationalize rolling stock, and there are three traditional locomotives that you can purchase. So you can sell the diesel vehicle because they are not efficient. So yes, you can say that, oh my god, in Russia or in the United States there is diesel traction in many places. So in the United States we can find videos with diesel engines pulling 3 kilometer long trains. Yeah, with 3 kilometer long trains and with cargo everywhere, then we can have this impression that it can be profitable. Just in Europe, all the train stations are shorter than 350 meters. So it limits the length of the train. Sometimes it's only 600 meters. So that's why you have to be efficient in traction. And also, the size or the height of the train is limited as well, so you can't go above 4 meters sometimes. So it means that you have to fit and you have to be small. And that's why actually diesel traction is profitable around 100 kilometers. Sometimes they are doing a bit longer distances, but actually this is the thumb rule that yeah, it can be much better. So that's why our Vostok Euro is not that competitive. That's the reason that companies are not forcing themselves into the business of purchasing brand new diesel locomotives, because you can purchase on the secondary market used ones and they are still operational. So so we can see that the traction power is a bit small. Why? Because actually you have to bring your power plant with yourself. So actually there is a huge and noisy diesel engine inside the train. And it consumes a lot of fuel. It was really hard to find real data, but that was the best approximation and estimation that what can be in the average consumption. And usually the other problem with diesel engines that because of the most of the moving parts are in the diesel engine, and also there is electric part because it runs a generator, then generator electricity, then the wheels are moved by an electric motor or more electric motors. So there are many components, way more than in an electric engine. So if you are purchasing one of the three electric engines, what you can see, so Siemens, Vectron, Skoda, or Softronic Transmontana, then actually it's they are very simpler. They get the electricity from the grid, so the line above the vehicle, and then there are some transformators and so on. In the past, so what you can see in the Hungarian network, in most of the cases, the for or not the first, but they were the first modern electric locomotives which used semiconductors. But still, they used many relays and other mechanical components. Nowadays, most of them are also semiconductors. So in the last two decades, there was a huge evolution in high power semiconductor manufacturing, and that's why they have way less components. So, and also the vehicle are way more reliable. They are not burning down as much as the older ones, and also they can provide you higher speed, better acceleration, and what is really good for us, power. And they can have regenerative brakes. What it means that if you are slowing down, then you are generating electricity back to the grid. So, for example, you can think about a Tesla car. If you are slowing down with the Tesla car, then you are regenerating electricity to your batteries. That's the same thing, just in this case you are giving back electricity to the railway electricity network, and in this case you can cut down your expenditure. So from financial point of view, what matters here that you can reduce your expenditures because of this. Obviously you can do it with a diesel engine because you can't regenerate. Yeah, if you are exhausting or making CO2 from diesel oil, you can't convert it backwards because you are slowing down. So it would be a nice thing, just not works at all. And you can see that they can be a bit expensive. So Siemens Vectron is the most expensive, the other is less expensive if you are looking on the data. So it's completely up to you, because right now it's a financial stuff that which one is chosen. You can optimize. There is no best or most optimal solution in this case, so you don't have to be afraid. All the vehicles have a Wikipedia page, so you can read it if you want. You can play with this. And of course, we have to listen on the Vectron. So if you have 4 million euros, then you can enjoy this voice. And after that, the company has real estate. So some land, some buildings are useless, some buildings can be sold on the market. Actually, just for fun, that you, if you need some liquidity, then you can have them. Also, you can have the cash reserves, some part of it in euros, some parts of are in Hungarian forints. You have some supplies, okay, you can rid of it. Also, you can have some shareholders' equity. You have some corporate bonds, and the problem is that there is an existing debt for 2 million euros, and now they are running out. So they will expire. So that's why you have to issue new bonds, or you have to find some new funding. So you can say that, okay, I will take up a syndicated loan for 2 million euros with this interest rate, or you can issue bonds potentially. So in this case, this data is a potential. So you can say that, oh, I can take up only, or I would like to take up a loan of 1.5 million euros because it fits to my strategy. It doesn't matter, just this is the top limit that you can take up only at most 2 million or maximum 2 million or maximum 3 million euro bond can be issued. And yeah, it's fairly valued, so yes. Also, you have a balance sheet. And in this case, you can see that, oh my god, how I can calculate this easily, because on the seminars, we've been working with the same stuff in Excel. So it's already written and calculated in Excel, and it's interlinked with the profit and loss statement. So actually, I made it for 2 years, and they are cross-linked. And also, we can see here that the exchange rates are predefined, so we can play that, we can change them, and we can see how it affects the company's profitabilities. Later on, it will be useful. Also, you can see here that what is the data, so fuel and electricity consumption. If you were afraid that, oh my god, I have to calculate all the assumptions, no, everything is pre-calculated for you. So you can see that if you are choosing Siemens Vectron, you have such an expenditure in each currency, because obviously, in the case of diesel engine, you put all the gasoline in the Vostok Euro, in Hungary, for Hungarian forint, they are burning annually 2.1 billion Hungarian forints into CO2 and some dust, and that's all. But if you are using electric locomotives, obviously you will have expenditures in Czech koruna in euros as well, because you have to pay for the Czech infrastructure company, you have to pay for the Austrian infrastructure company, because you need electricity from there, because you are using the lines, so that's the difference. And also, you can see the maintenance fees, and you can see the depreciation, annual depreciation, so it's calculated already for you, so you don't have to be afraid of it, it's there. Also, there is a plan for rebalancing, but we will talk about it on the seminar, so I don't want to mix stuff here. So here is the data. So profit and losses. So here we can see that revenues are coming from pulling this train. So actually, RGS container carriage, what is that? Yes, this one is. Oh, actually, it's also real. So it's a real carriage which can contain some containers. It has weight, length, and so on. Doesn't matter. Just you can see that I try to collect everything. And at full load, we have such amount of tons. So that's why I mentioned to you that mostly in Europe or elsewhere, freight trains are going only at 100 kilometers per hour. Container trains can be faster, so sometimes you can see data about 160 kilometers per hour, but still there is an issue of slowing down. And if so, if you are in the US, when there are completely empty rural areas and you don't have to slow down because there are not so many train stations, then you can go ahead. But in Europe, it's much densely lived territory, so it's harder to slow down. We have to slow down way more often. Also, there is an issue with different electricity standards. So in northern Czechia there is DC, then southern Czechia there is Hungarian type of AC. In Austria or in Germany there is a completely different AC because of historical reasons and because of engineering reasons. It was way easier to build such an infrastructure. In the past, just you need special power plants. In this case, you can use industrial electricity, which is made by ordinary power plants, like used by households, and in this case, you can build cheaper engines. Just the electricity grid will be way less efficient, so it's more expensive to operate. So that's why nowadays everybody tries to build infrastructure with this electricity. But actually, these modern locomotives can operate under all of them, so it doesn't matter for us anymore that you need three different locomotives. No, it's this problem has been solved in the last two decades. And yeah, so you can see that you have this mileage and you have these working hours. So actually you can make your job within a day, so you can turn around and deliver your stuff what is necessary. For people who need data, actually you can have all the calculations here, but you don't need this to solve the case study. It just supports my numbers here. Also, what is not so necessary, but I collected all the data from the infrastructure service providers from all the countries, and you can see that how my actually how the costs here, that railway usage fees, were calculated. So they were completely based on these two tables, just to be precise. Actually, they should be annexes, but it's much better to keep it here. Railway usage fees, yeah, you can see it here. Vehicle-related expenditures. It's already there, just you can see it again here. Prices and fees. So I calculated the entire case study with these numbers. And obviously, if currencies are changing, oh my God, then we will adapt to it. So we have to check, obviously, at the exchange rate management part that, or exchange rate risk management part, that what is happening under different exchange rates. So in the past, this 315 was a good approximation, so we can see that, oh, it was nicely related to this thing, but now, yes, 360. And what is happening with the Czech koruna to Hungarian forints? Oh, it's not a good sign for the company because we have only expenditures in this thing. Groovy. And also you can see the interest rates. They are still good enough. So you can see here the exchange rate of the Hungarian forint against the kruna and the euro, and we can see that it has this welcoming depreciating nature. Also interest rates, they are decreasing. Yeah. To the wages, actually I defined in the past, now they are a bit nothing stuff, but still there are wages for the executive board, there are wages for the operative level, under different divisions you can read them. If you have questions at what is their purpose, you can ask them, but you know, you can fire anyone if you want, not the top management, or and you can't change the wages yet, but you can think about that. How can you operate, who is redundant and who is not, and of course profit and loss statement is defined, and we have the following issues, so railway usage fees, you have the fuel or electricity costs, maintenance, renting fees, because we have some renting issues in Austria, and otherwise maintenance, vehicle maintenance should be done in Hungary, in Hungarian forints, because there is a locomotive located. We have the wages, if you want to fire people, then you can do it. Depreciation of the vehicle and depreciation of the buildings in Czechia and in Hungary. And we have EBIT, so it goes to here, so subsidiaries, gained interest after our bank deposit, paid interest after our corporate debt or bond right now, pre-tax profit, corporate income tax, corporate profit after tax, and dividend 20%, and profit for the year is highly negligible. So we are profitable only because we have bank deposits and it provides us some income, because on operational level we are in losses. So yeah, it's rubbish. And after that, we have this modeling issue. So how can we rationalize the company? It's not only in Excel, we can do it in MATLAB, and we will play with that. So you can check the lecture notes, because they are also at the same time seminar notes, that what can you do. Please read it, because it's necessary. If you are interested in the topic of railway infrastructure, actually with some googling you can find this really good review paper on the internet, because they are writing about all the basic stuff, that how it works here, what are the concepts in Europe. Actually you can see that literally this railway line exists, what I'm talking about. So it's a traffic corridor. What is a traffic corridor? Also you can find this. Actually transit time to from China to Europe, it takes 1 month on the sea, is less to between 2 or 3 weeks on railways, so there can be different pathways and opportunities. So for going through, what is this? Yeah, sorry. So going from here back and forth with the containers, and also some other information is provided. Sometimes it's a bit useless, but yeah. So if you want basic data, then you can find here if you have any questions. Okay, so see you tomorrow, and if you have any questions, please do not hesitate to ask personally in email or on the call space, because still we have a forum on call space. You can check it. It's here, there is a Q&A session, and I already shared something with you. So